shining as the sun. We know less days to sing God's praise than when we first.
God bless you. I am Mark Anthony DiBello. Let's open our day in this message with prayer. Holy Father, Lord above, thank you for being the kind of God who hears and answers prayer. Thank you for being who you are and how you are. Thank you for your Son, your angels, your nature, and your creation, including us, humanity. Thank you, Father, for letting us come together. You say where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are amongst us. So every time somebody listens to my voice, prayerfully, your Holy Spirit enlightens and comforts and indwells whomever might be listening. Holy Father, please forgive us for our sins and our weaknesses, our imperfections, our unholiness, our lack of obedience, our disservice to you and to one another. Please forgive us for any of our sins or commandments that we break or your law. Holy Father, please bless us this day. As your heavenly prayer says, give us this day our daily gifts, our daily bread. Prosper us physically and financially, as it may be your will that we be blessed materially. But if not, then so be it, because we know nothing with us to the other side except our Holy Spirit within us, prayerfully, into a place where one day we'll see our friends again, but mostly we'll see you and all the saints. So again, Father, please bless us and please bless this message. In Jesus' holy and heavenly name, through the power of the Holy Spirit and all for the glory of God the Father. Amen. Amen. Well, this message is a little tardy in the sense that yesterday's message on what is suicide, I believe, was not posted on time, but I'll get that posted. And we're going to keep in line with the series message of what is. started with what is sin, I believe, and what is suicide. Now, I believe in the next orderly message should be what is abortion. So I'm going to give a prayerfully a spiritual message on that, but I want to apologize because I've been giving consecutive messages, and tomorrow is Tuesday. I typically celebrate my Sabbath day of rest, and I'm honestly, for lack of better terms, burnt out and just need to take a spiritual day to be one with the Lord and not preach or not teach or share a message. So post yesterday's, get it posted today, what is suicide, and then in line with that, what is abortion today. So let me speak some about abortion. And prayerfully share some thoughts that might empower you and encourage you and in many ways protect you and warn you and spare you the pain and agony in this world that comes from breaking a commandment like the sixth commandment, which is thou shalt not kill, and then surely blessing you for eternity when this life perishes and our inner spirit meets with the Lord. And we prayerfully, as I outlined in other messages, get a new body and a new heaven and a new earth. So having said that, in the beginning, as the scripture says, God created. He's Father Time. Any of the concept of time, which is complex in itself. There's a point in scripture where he says, to me a day is a week and a week is a day, which means God is eternal past, he's in the present, he's eternal future. For him, time, and there is some Old Testament Jewish text which basically has a point that relates a day in the Bible is equivalent to a year in human life. But while God is a God of math and time, even that is not as complex as God is, because for God, a day could be a million years. On the first day God created, well, on the first day he created the, let there be light. Then he created all the plants, all the fish of the sea, all the animals. Well, these things are still being created and recreated and evolving. So even that day is still moving forward. You know, on the seventh day, he rested. But again, God has a time frame that's different than ours, in that he is everlasting and eternal, and in our sense of our human bodies, we are not. But anyway, we are in our spirit. But in this perishable human body, because of sin, which ceases and becomes deceased at one point. Again, our time is not God's. He tends to be, as we would relate to it, patient. But either way, the point is that in the beginning time, God created. He's a creator. His greatest creation, humankind. Scripture even says more so in many regards than the angels. The angels are jealous of us that they cannot have this life in the form that, in the form that we have it. So Lord God created us, created his animals, created the universe and every planet and every rock in it, the darkness of space, the light, space itself, I mean just things that we can't still even conceive, God created. His nature is to be a creator. I personally love, it's one of the best parts of my life is to create, if not the best, to create something. I just feel so one with him. I mean, just that ability to create, just the concept of a creation of anything. It could be a writing, a painter, it could be a thought, an idea. Just that creative process is amazing to me. It truly is divine. It's something that God instituted. Some people are not, God bless them, they have other qualities or gifts, but they're not necessarily creative. I feel for those people that they're missing just an aspect or an attribute of the Creator, like I'm missing other attributes. I'm not to sound haughty in that way. I'm just saying that the gift of creation is an amazing gift that the Lord God gave us, miraculous and holy and wonderful and godly gift. So if creation is such a part of God, well, what more of a valuable creation than humankind? God created as his Son, you have the Holy Spirit, have the angels in heaven, the angels on earth, the universe, the animal kingdom, but humanity, in God's image, he created them, man and woman, in God's image. He didn't say that necessarily about the animals. He didn't say certainly that about the earth itself, although we are very synergistic and one with the earth in that we were created from the dust of the ground of it. So material earth, physical body earth is very similar to physical body humanity. Did you know, in fact, that, and this is not coincidence, and I found this to be a very profound thing that I had picked up or learned along the way, or actually I was blessed because I put it together. I didn't put it together, but the fact is that the human body is composed of 70% water. Not unlike the earth is comprised of 70% water. The oceans, the seas comprise 70% of the earth. And the human body, as any doctor or even scientist can tell you, I guess scientist would tell you that the human body is composed of 70% water. That is not coincidental. So when I say I put it together, I just took one piece of information that I heard right after I heard the other piece of information and realized from the scriptures that God created man from the man from the dust of the ground, that can't be a coincidence, and it's not. Verify scripture, but more so just shows you our oneness with the planet in that way. So anyway, having said that, my point with creation is that it's as godlike as it gets. And as I've taught, and you know, and I'm sure you know, Satan is a destroyer. He's a murderer. His goal is to destroy humankind. He tried to destroy Jesus. He tries to destroy the planet. To try everything God created, Satan is trying to constantly destroy. Especially humanity. So it's Satan who kills, God who creates. And if humanity is God's greatest gift, how imperative and important is it, do you think, to Satan to try to kill that gift? And he tries to do so as soon as possible. Constantly and immediately. So let me just sort of reinstitute this message on abortion. That in the beginning, God created. And one of the first commands, if not the first command he gave man, apart from do not eat from the tree of knowledge and the tree of life, so that you don't lose yours, was to be fruitful and multiply. Be fruitful and multiply. Not don't be fruitful and don't multiply. Not kill your child. Not kill the baby in the womb. Not kill each other. But be fruitful and multiply. Now this in its way is something God himself, as powerful and omnipotent as he is, even in a way he can't do. You briefly heard me talk about how Jesus came as in the virgin birth to his mother Mary. They didn't, him, she and Joseph didn't have relations. Jesus himself never had sexual relations with a woman. He was never married. He never impregnated a woman. So even God himself couldn't and wasn't really a physical part of the union between a man and a woman, the physical union that leads to birth, the birthing process. And God, we know one of the greatest, if not the greatest power that God gave us is free will, human choice. He didn't create robots, and I'll do a message on human choice later, but he didn't create robots. He gave us, just like he didn't create robots in Adam and Eve, he gave them free will choice. A loving, perfect creator, when you really, truly love something, you give it its mind and its heart and its will to make its own choice. Surely you want that to be the Father's choice, your creator's choice. He knows the best choice you can make. He will help you if you make the wrong choice. He will bless you if you make the correct choice. The Bible says, choose this day that which you will do, a blessing or a curse. So you have the unlimited, the blessed, godly power of human choice to make your own choice, a choice that which should always be made out of love and life. Not any of the countless sinful choices, hatred, selfishness, greed, comfort. I mean, whatever choice that you would choose to circumvent the birth process and destroy a life. Murder. It's no less than murder. No less than murder at all. So with this amazing and divine, powerful choice of human will and human choice and the commandment and our choice to perpetuate humanity, to be fruitful and multiply. The Lord God knew how he designed man and woman and how they would have to repopulate the planet and become divine creators in our own right. God isn't going to keep creating Adams. He wasn't going to keep creating Eves. He did it once. Actually, as you've heard me say, we only try to and self-extinguish ourselves. The devil tries to eradicate all of humanity, and every time we've come near extinction, God has had to do any and everything he could do to keep us alive. He did it with Noah. He did it by sending his son Jesus to spare us from in this life. He's promised us a new life and a new body. This is the last one, seventh time. I'll get into this message later, but all the times past where man became virtually extinct, one person away basically from becoming extinct, and the Lord God intervened to save us. And again, he wouldn't recreate a man like he did Adam. He gave us that power to populate the planet and reproduce ourselves. But we need to do it. And we have to do it in our humanity. Yes, we need God's divine blessing upon it. But we have to have a human interaction, man to a woman, and not any other way. As much as people think it's technologically productive, and I'll get into that, but there's a reason some people are blessed to be able to be childbearing, some women. Some men have a fruitful seed, others do not. I mean, surely God would have it that everybody does, but in the plan that God the Father sees and knows that there is evil, he's willing to forgive and work with that, if you will. I mean, for those women who cannot have a child, there's the adoption option. God has it all calculated. There's a point in this story that I wrote where I related to all the eggs in an Easter basket. You know, if those who couldn't have eggs were to adopt from those who could, who didn't want their eggs, that if everybody either adopted or just gave birth as they should, everybody would have, you know, who wanted to, would have children, would have a family. That if we just abolished abortion, if in human will, your choice to abolish abortion, that God would have it just perfectly, everybody would be blessed and in peace and pleased with their family, their children. But that will never be on this planet. So the point is that God has given us his command to be fruitful and to multiply and to replenish the planet, and that divine choice to do so. So there's no more grievous a sin to God, the Creator, than to kill his creation. So when, and many people ask this, and I wrote about this in this story from the messages I got from the Lord God above and the Archangel Michael, who is the defender of life. The Archangel Michael is the defender of life. He's the one who wars with Satan at the end of time to destroy Satan for eternity. So Michael is fully aware of the blessing of life. It was the Archangel Gabriel who delivered the message to Mary. So the Archangels, Michael, Gabriel, sent from God the Father above to mention and note and announce the triumphant birth of the Lord Jesus Christ, the babe himself. I mean, what would have happened, thank God, if some faithful parents like Mary and Joseph aborted Jesus? What if they aborted Jesus Christ? That could have been done. There were abortions back then. Certainly not as prevalent, I'm quite certain, as today, where Satan is amping and ramping up his desire to murder, coming up with new and perverted, not creative ways, but perverted ways to murder one another. But the archangels delivered that blessed message to Mary. If she didn't hear and to listen and to be obedient and be faithful and have her belief in the Lord God above and Joseph, her mate, her husband, Jesus' father, where would this earth be? Extinct and in hell. Where would people be? Extinct and in hell. Not the earth itself, the people on the earth, extinct and in hell. So when does birth begin? When does conception begin? Conception begins at the thought. When it began when God gave the command to be fruitful and multiply. Any murder at any time during since that process is a sin. Any murder since that time is a sin. So if you're a parent in a married couple, not a single couple committing adultery, not homosexual mates deciding to adopt or do some other insemination process, unnatural, woman to woman. But if you're married, like Adam and Eve, like Mary and Joseph, and you're a parent, and the Lord God, who had already asked you to be fruitful and multiply, if he puts it in your heart, the time and when, the thought, the loving desire to give birth to a family. After prayerful meditation and consultation with the Father above, the Creator, Lord says, you know what, now's the time. I'd love to bless you with a child. You have to work with me. You have to give me your thought, your prayerful meditation on this. Let's commune on this. This is going to be your son, Holy Father. God says to the parents, this is my blessing to you. As soon as you have that thought, you have conceived. When God and prayerfully the parents each have the Holy Spirit and the child will be brought up in the ways of the Lord, that as soon as you have that thought, as soon as he puts that thought as a common thought between you and he and you and your Creator, you have given birth. Spiritually, you have given birth. The way we were all birthed into this existence, spiritually first. Then God wrapped the body around the spirit. So as a woman is impregnated, that human body, from that second, that millisecond, that fraction of time, I already spoke about time, that is immeasurable, that time right between humanity and God, unfathomable, the short amount of that time, millisecond, if that's even a measure of time. You've become one with God. In your image, we created him. We created man in our image, in God's image, Jesus' image, the Holy Spirit. In our image, he created them. So when you have that union, that immediate godliness, let's say, in you, you have created. You have conceived. You have given birth. And then the natural physical process takes hold. So immediately after that first conscious thought, anything after that in the way of destroying or allowing Satan to get into your mind, the woman's mind, the husband's mind, the doctor's mind who commit this heinous sin of murder, whomever, the friend who tells you to do, or even your parents who might tell you if you're a younger person, let's say, you should abort. That is murder, period. No less than child sacrifice, perhaps, that equated to the old days, or the days when that was practiced. It's still practiced today. Child sacrifice. You're sacrificing your child by murdering your child in a way. Not for God's glory. You're not crucifying your child as Jesus was crucified. You're probably doing it out of any possible evil reason that Satan can come up with. Selfishness could be anything, comfort, convenience, financial reasons, whatever the case may be. But if you kill any egg, even the spermatozoa, any part of the process, you're murdering. And that leads me to something I've already mentioned in one of these messages before, birth control. Birth control is murder. You don't have to have a baby exit the womb to have it be aborted. It can be aborted in male. There's now male birth control. I had prophesied about this abortion pill 10, 12 years ago when I wrote the Archangel. I'm sorry, 2000. This is 2014. So 14 years ago, RU486, or I'm not sure exactly the name of it now, but and now there's this the abortion pill, and it's just getting more murderous, easier to do. But birth control, it keeps the egg. God, where would life be without eggs? Just look at the animal kingdom. No egg, no animal. You know, I even noted that Noah, you don't hear it mentioned or see or read it mentioned in the Bible, but I believe I divinely received the message that part of the Noah repopulating the planet or saving the planet and taking two of all kind of animals to the ark, there were eggs on board. He had eggs of these animals. Without the egg, there's no, at least certainly in humankind. I don't know all the animal kingdom, but I think perhaps every animal has an egg, does it not? Has to be born with an egg? Or born of an egg? You kill the egg, you kill the baby. You kill the egg, you kill the person. So just the birth control, any birth control process, man or woman at any time, is murder, is abortion. Well, in the last few minutes here, about 3 minutes to close, just know that the Lord God loves his creation. He loves you. He loves man. He loves woman. He's given you free will choice. Prayerfully, excuse me, you make the right choice, the life-giving choice, the godly choice. And you create, you don't destroy. Surely God will forgive those who did, if you only ask him. If you've had And we've all, I know, I don't say we all, but I believe perhaps the most pervasive sin on the planet is adultery. And adultery so is related to birth control or marriage or abortion. That the Lord God, He will forgive, He will restore, He is merciful. But choose this day how you will exist, in a blessing or a curse. And that's really what we need to do as a commandment from God. So again, God, please forgive anybody who has murdered or has the thought to murder. Please forgive us for our temptation and our trap of falling into Satan's lies and Satan's murderous ways rather than your fruitful and blessed and life-giving and glorious, perfect, and holy ways. Please, Holy Father, bless every man, woman, and child. Either in the womb or in this life having been birthed or even in the mind and heart and the thought process. Please bless them all. And Holy Father, thank you for this time together, the opportunity to be one with you in your heart and your mind when it comes to your greatest gift, the gift of life. And we thank you and we praise you. We worship you and we adore you. And we love you and thank you for life. May God bless you. Amen. God bless you, everybody. God bless you. God bless you. I am Mark Anthony DiBello. Let's open our day in this message with prayer. Holy Father, Lord above, thank you for being the kind of God who hears and answers prayer. Thank you for being who you are and how you are. Thank you for your Son, your angels, your nature, and your creation, including us, humanity. Thank you, Father, for letting us come together. You say where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are amongst us. So every time somebody listens to my voice, prayerfully, your Holy Spirit enlightens and comforts and indwells whomever might be listening. Holy Father, please forgive us for our sins and our weaknesses, our imperfections, our unholiness, our lack of obedience, our disservice to you and to one another. Please forgive us for any of our sins or commandments that we break or your law. Holy Father, please bless us this day. As your heavenly prayer says, give us this day our daily gifts, our daily bread. Prosper us physically and financially, as it may be your will that we be blessed.
Shame, oh,
touch me. Oh, he touched me. He touched me. And what joy, wonderful joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Oh, since I met this blessed Savior, and since he cleansed and made me whole,
something